just getting ready to finish these couple of back pieces off now. I'm going to have a plug socket here at the side and then one behind where I sit. This will be handy for sort of my lamp and things, and then that I tend to plug in camera and stuff like that when I'm filming. So I've got this cable ready to go. I've cut a hole out. I'm going to reuse one of the plugs from the old workshop, fit it flush in because that used to look quite nice. And then what I've done is I've basically just routed out a channel down the back of there for the cable to sit in, and then I'll get the plug fixed. So I'm going to fix that up now onto this end wall, then move on to the back. Okay, so I've got the end piece on there, as you've just seen, and I've got my end plug sockets on. As I say, I've reused those from the old workshop, not that I'd expect you to recognise them, but it's the old plates, it's not cost me anything for that. That's all nicely wired in. So the next thing to do is to get this back piece on. I've remarked the stud locations so I can see what I'm doing for drilling the holes in those and where I'm mounting those. So I'm going to be able to bite probably six screws, decent sized screws, into the studs there. That should be absolutely fine, because of course the weight of it is actually taken up by the top underneath essentially, but sometimes if I mount the filming jig thing with the camera on, well, there's quite a lot of cantilever weight on it, so it does need to be nice and strong, but yeah, we are nearly there. I'm just finishing off this piece of bench top here. I fixed that upstand on just with some screws, which is why the screw caps, I don't really like screw caps because they don't look very neat. I didn't want to start sticking that to the wall, because if I ever need to replace these worktops or anything like that, I don't want to start ripping all the wall to bits. I made that mistake in the other workshop, and the grab adhesive made a right mess. So for the sake of seeing three white screw caps, I can just easily take that off if I need to. And then I'm just fixing this other plug socket here. I've been very pleased with these. I think these look nice. You can see that one down there, so it gives you the finished look of them, but I think they look quite nice. They do remind me a little bit of a sort of science lab or something at school, which is probably what they're actually designed for. But they're nice and easy. You just bring the cable in the side, connect them into the chocky block, and away it goes, and then your cover goes on top. I'll just finish the trim on the end there, and then we're that's this top piece done. Somebody may also be thinking, well, why didn't you just nail that to the wall? As I say, these studs in here seem to be on 2 foot centres or 60 centimetre centres, whatever they're on. So those bits of yellow tape there are actually marking where the studs are. There just really wouldn't have been very much to nail to. There's no point really trying to just nail straight into plasterboard. There's no, you know, there's no strength in it at all. So that works fine anyway. But I've just connected this back up. So hopefully, give it the old tester, then that should be working, except it's not, because I haven't turned it on under here. There, look. So in this cupboard down here, don't mind the tape around the edge there, the jigsaw made a bit of a ragged finish, so I was just taping it around to stop it getting any worse. I've got access to both of the sort of fly leads, if you like, for those plugs there. As I said, they're basically just extension leads, it's not fixed wiring. But if I ever needed to replace the fuse in there or isolate one off or something like that, and then I could do that. So if I actually just flick that one on now, that should light the other one up. And there we go. These socket testers are very useful. Basically, if you get three lights, it says correct, okay, look, any other combination. Means there's basically something a bit wrong, but very useful just to give yourself the okay when you've done any socket work there. So I just need to cut another little piece of upstand just to finish that end off, and that'll be the back of there looking nice. So the socket layout that I've ended up with in here basically now is a twin on either end of this bench. I've got a twin over there to the left of where I'll be sat, and then when I get the back piece in there, I'll have a twin in the middle. So I'll have eight sockets. It's not because I need to plug in eight things at once. It's just to give you, you know, ability to move around without trailing wires too far. I've got one of these Google pod things there that I got for free in the corner. That's quite a good offer, actually. That was a John Lewis in the UK. If you spent something like £50, you got a free Google thing. So when I bought some of the bedding for the house, you know, a quilt cover, whatever it was, basically got a free Google radio thing with it. So that's useful. But yeah, I think that's ample. And then I've got a couple of sockets on this wall here as well, if I did want to plug anything in at that side. So that should be ample for power, hopefully. And it just makes use of those four sockets which have ended up being hidden, obviously down there where you can't actually see them. So there's not too much left to do in here now. I need to do the little bit of end trim there. This piece here needs an upstand cutting, not an upstand, an end panel cutting down to cover that up there. The other piece of end panel, the offcut of that, I'm going to put on there. That's had all sorts mounted on it in the old workshop, and it's a bit of a mess. It's full of holes, as you can see. So I think I'll put the offcut on there just to neaten that up. And then, as I said, I've got this back piece to fix here. I'm just waiting on the socket arriving because it's a special USB one as well, and I can do the cutouts. Okay, I'm just building the drawer boxes for the new drawer unit that I've got here. These IKEA boxes do go together very easily. The kind of four main pieces just all click together, and then you lock it all together with your fronts. I've got some handles which are different from the other handles because they don't do those anymore. The fronts match as closely as I could get. So basically, when you put your handles on, obviously you need to think about where you want them. Sometimes if there's a kind of pattern like this, it sort of dictates where the handle's going to go. Other times you've got a little bit more, you know, artistic license, I suppose. But on these, the handle's going to need to go sort of in the middle of this flat part here, and then in the middle of the drawer. Anywhere else would look a little bit weird. So on the packets, these are Calrua handles, I don't know. See where it says CC 160 millimeters, that's your centers. So that's what you need to drill, you know, 160 on center. So basically I've got a square set up here, and what I've done is I've measured the distance of the flat part, which I think was 48, halved it to 24, and then just fiddled about working out the exact distance to come in from the side so that I can make a little cross. You can see I was slightly off on my first measurement. That's why I've corrected it there. Measure twice, cut once, as always. Once you've got a square set like that, you can then just mark up all your drawers, no problem. If I was doing a massive kitchen, I might make a jig or something for this. You know, if I had 40 drawer fronts or something stupid. I've got four to do, so there's no point making a jig for these. I'll just mark it on the tape accurately with this square, and that should be fine. Unfortunately, a couple of the drawer fronts are damaged. I need to get replacements for those, but I can get a couple done. When you come to drill for something like this, you want to use what's called either a brad point or a lip and spur bit. It's the same thing, but rather than a sort of standard, you know, like metal looking drill bit, it's the one that's got a very tiny little point in the middle there. So that's what gives you the accuracy, because you can take the point and you can line it up exactly on the mark that you've made. You otherwise, if you use a different type of drill bit, it's a little bit fuzzy as to where you're starting it. So that's what you want for doing that kind of cabinet work there. As well, obviously your holes need to go through nice and straight, otherwise your screws will all bind up. Drilling straight is much more difficult than people think. I mean, this isn't, you know, fine metal engineering, it's still wood, but it still wants to be something like, if you've not got a pillar drill, obviously a pillar drill is going to be the easiest way to do that. Something I've shown on videos before, which I find very handy, is this thing called a gator block. Big Gator Tools V drill guide. They do a metric and an imperial. Essentially, it's got all the different drill sizes on, and then obviously it's machined flat. It's also got a thing so you can put it on a pipe. That's why it's got a V in it. You know, if you need to drill into to tap a pipe or something round. But if you put that on something flat like this, you clamp it or hold it nice and flat, insert your drill bit into the right sized hole, and that will guide your drill bit nice and straight through whatever it is. If you've got something that's too big to get under a pillar drill, that's especially handy, because obviously you can't, you know, get like a door or something like that under a pillar drill. But you can hold or clamp this against sort of any flat surface, get yourself a nice straight hole. So these are very handy to have in your toolbox, and it's one of those things that's just going to last forever, nowhere to break it really. So they're you know, super useful. And then for drilling the holes, what you see people doing sometimes is sort of, you know, trying to line up a bolt like this with a drill bit and eyeballing it and seeing if it looks like the right one. A very handy thing to own is one of these. This is a drill gauge, and it basically just has holes of incremental sizes in. You sometimes get a cheap plastic one of these with a set of drill bits as well, a smaller one. But if you're trying to think, oh, you know, what size hole do I need for this bolt? You can basically just work your way up until you find which hole it will first drop through, and whatever size hole that is, that's what drill bit you need. In this case, I think these are 4 millimeters. But if it won't go through the 3.5 and it will go through the 4, then 4 millimeter drill bit. Okay, there's the back piece in, which you've just seen me do. I'd already marked where the studs were, which was what I was doing with the laser. So I've got 6 big screws. I realised these weren't even big enough. I've got some 80mm screws straight through the top, straight through the plasterboard, straight into the studs. 6 of those. That should be plenty strong enough to hold this. So I'm pleased with that. I've kind of recreated what I had in my old workshop, except that used to be kind of at that side. Obviously now I've got all this extra bench once I get all the rubbish cleared off it, obviously. But I'm pleased with that. The reason there's a little gap there, by the way, is that is a standard length of worktop. I think they do something like 186 and 240 or something. There was no point in me getting the bigger piece of worktop just to cut off everything by an inch. And my shelving thing that I put my little bits and bobs on will be going there anyway. I've still got a couple of bits of trim to do around there just to tidy that up.